Welcome to the introductory lecture. We hope that the course will benefit the participants. If you have any problems, please let us know at the email address on the website. Instead of a long introduction, let's turn to the subject. The section focuses on the ultrasound presentation of thyroid nodules. The backbone of the section is the discussion of the various features which should be analyzed on ultrasound examination. We talk about their role in differential diagnostics, in various thyroid systems, their occurrence in the most frequent subtype of cancers. And first of all, we present thousands of images and more than 1,000 video records only in this section. The analysis of these voiceover videos serves both as educational material and as the greatest collection available in the web has been used by many colleagues in everyday differential diagnostic problems for more than a decade. The section starts with an introduction about the role of ultrasound in differential diagnostics of nodular goiter and finishes with a topic in which we try to give an approach how to integrate the various findings in a single option. Several related topics will be discussed in a separate chapter. These are the relation between a discrete equiabnormality and the pathological nodule, the substernal spread and difficult to analyze patterns, and the complex analysis of the thyroid systems. While discussing the role of ultrasound in the evaluation of thyroid patients, we should never forget about the goals of the evaluation which define what to do. So, what are the goals of the evaluation of a suspected nodular goiter disease? The first task is to determine whether the patient has thyroid nodule or not. Answering this question, we rely exclusively on the thyroid ultrasound. Except for extremely rare cases, the ultrasound defines the presence of thyroid nodule. Considering the absence of effective medication in the event of a thyroid nodule, the very relevant issue is whether to operate the patient or not. The next question relies on those patients who do not require surgery. We need to decide which patients should be monitored and how often this should be recommended. And now we have finished. So, is there a nodule present? Is surgery necessary? If not, is a check required, and if so, how often? Let's see the role of ultrasound in these cases. The ultrasound has an almost exclusive role in defining thyroid nodules. Beside clinical examination and TSH test, ultrasound is the only method we need to perform in each case to clarify the second problem. These tools play a major role, with the exclusive role in most cases. With regard to the last question, it can again be said that ultrasound plays a crucial role. The first problem is the most neglected issue in the thyroid literature. Most authors pretend that the problem of defining a nodule does not even exist. In fact, in the everyday practice, this is the least resolved problem with serious implications for the investigation procedure as a whole. What is the relation between a discrete echoabnormality and the pathological nodule? In what sense does the ultrasound examiner use the term nodule? How to differentiate discrete lesions found in more than 90% of Hashimoto's thyroiditis? We have no answers, as we have not yet come to ask this question. A separate chapter will be devoted to this problem at a later point in the course. Okay, the relation between a discrete lesion on ultrasound and a pathological nodule is not clarified. Okay, this problem will be discussed in detail later. In view of all this, I cannot say that I will not give you any help in clarifying this issue at this point. Some considerations. Firstly, it is preferred using nodule in pathological sense and not using this term for discrete equiabnormalities of Hashimoto thyroiditis, which may be either more active foci of thyroiditis or the opposite, areas which are not influenced by thyroiditis. Both patients had Hashimoto thyroiditis and presented with the most common form of this. Both the larger hyperechoic areas in the left and the smaller discrete lesions in the right case should be regarded as more active foci of the disease and not of pathological nodules. Second, I restrict the use of nodule for those lesions which are larger than 10 mm in diameter, and for those between 5 and 10 mm, which show at least one of the suspicious signs. Both patients presented with several discrete cystic lesions. However, these patterns should not be regarded as abnormal. If we use the term nodule for these small cystic areas, we simply stigmatize the patient and cause unnecessary anxiety. Such lesions are best named as discrete areas of non-pathological size. We turn to the role of ultrasound to determine which nodule to operate. There are three distinct reasons for thyroid surgery. There is a fourth reason, the wish of the patient, but strictly speaking, this cannot be considered a professional reason. The first is an autonomously functioning adenoma, which causes hyperthyroidism. In this regard, the role of ultrasound is mainly the measurement of the nodule. Another important task is to examine the whole thyroid in order to decide whether surgery or radioiodine therapy would be the appropriate choice of definitive therapy. The left case is a typical presentation of an autonomously functioning adenoma causing hyperthyroidism. The upper image shows the adenoma. Because of the low TSH level, the contralateral lobe gets decreased in size. The situation is almost similar in the left patient. Almost. There is an adenoma marked with wire arrows in the ventral part of the right lobe, while the lower image shows the left lobe, which has decreased in size. This case illustrates the importance of ultrasound in seemingly simple cases. This patient had another nodule dorsal to the autonomously functioning one. This nodule, marked with red arrows, proved to be a papillary cancer. In connection with the second question, ultrasound plays a much more important role. During the course, a separate chapter will be devoted to the topic in the advanced section. One of the most important messages of the whole course is the statement highlighted in red. A lot of seniors have learned that a nodule larger than a certain size, namely 3 cm, is synonymous with surgery. Since a significant proportion of teachers do not perform ultrasound themselves, this magic 3 cm as a surgical indication limit is often said even now. However, it is clear that compression symptoms are caused not by a nodule, but by the enlarged lobe. This is again a very simple finding, which is very often not taken into account by experienced endocrinologists either. It is not the size of a nodule, but the size of the nodular thyroid lobe that determines whether a goiter can cause compression symptoms. An ultrasound finding that does not include the 3 diameters of the lobe is completely worthless. It is incomprehensible if the finding indicates that it is normal or slightly larger. This patient had a large nodule, the length exceeded 5 cm. Normally, such nodules require surgery. However, in this patient, the relatively large nodule caused only a minimal degree of enlargement. When the volume of the lobe of 12 ml is compared to the normal upper limit, we see that the value is slightly higher for a woman and normal for a man. The judgment on the degree of goiter is substantially influenced by the position of the thyroid. The lower it is, the smaller its size can cause compression symptoms, and conversely, the higher it is, the larger its size can cause compression. The next role of ultrasound is the establishing of substernal spread. Ultrasound is the tool which defines the presence and the degree of substernal spread. The demonstration or exclusion of substernal spread influences both the decision on surgery and the need for a preoperative neck and upper mediastinal CT scan. As a rule, neck and upper mediastinal CT scan should be performed if the lower pole of the thyroid cannot be visualized during swallowing. The video shows how we can judge the spread to the chest. The longitudinal section of a large multinodular goiter is demonstrated. It means that the right side of the video shows the lower part of the thyroid. Examined by the neck held back in a supine position, the lower pole of the lobe is not visible. The critical point is whether the lower pole becomes visible when swallowed. In this case, this happened. During swallowing, the lower pole of the lobe is signed with white arrows. It means that significant substernal spread is unlikely in this case. Our approach is different for a nodule located in the isthmus, because the space between the skin and the trachea is the narrowest here, a much smaller nodule can cause the patient complaints. The case on the left shows this situation. The small nodule caused an uncomfortable feeling of pressure for the patient. A lesion of similar size in the case on the right did not cause any problems. Obviously, there is a significant difference in the sensitivity of humans. However, it is also worth saying here that the patient on the left was much thinner, so the nodule reached pretty much the level of the skin, but in the case on the right it was located almost 1 cm deeper because of the presence of adipose tissue. Considering these circumstances, in many cases it results in an awkward situation if the ultrasound examination is performed by someone, by the radiologist, other than who is saying the final word regarding the surgery, the clinician. A well-organized and well-functioning collaboration between the radiologist and the clinician can of course reduce the difficulty, but in my opinion the ideal situation is when the clinician, making the decision himself or herself, performs the ultrasound examination that underlies the decision. Instead of a template decision, a decision tailored to a particular patient requires a very close relationship between the endocrinologist who makes the decision and the radiologist who performs the study that underlined the decision. The third cause of surgery that is most commonly discussed in the literature is what guidelines would focus on, and this is malignancy or suspicion of malignancy. Let's see the algorithm which is usually suggested by guidelines published after 2006. There are slight differences between them, but the point in all cases is this. So, if a nodule is suspected, ultrasound and TSH determination should be performed. The role of scintigraphy is mainly restricted for patients with low TSH. In euthyroid and hypothyroid patients, and in those in whom thyroid autonomy was excluded, ultrasound determines what to do next. The indication of FNA depends on the size of the nodule and on the presence of suspicious ultrasound characteristics. Let's look at the critical points of the guidelines. The first is the suspicion of the nodule. In some ways, this is the very essence of the algorithm. The guidelines are the same, they include lesions which are palpable or suspicious on palpation being nodules and nodules found during other imaging procedures. No guideline considers ultrasound screening to be warranted. It means that neither ultrasound screening nor the examination of the thyroid during carotid Doppler examination is justified. Numerous studies have confirmed that the disadvantages of ultrasound screening outweigh the benefits of screening. For those who are all new to this, I definitely recommend reading this medical study. The story is very instructive, but it is beyond the scope of this course to go into detail. The essence of the ultrasound screening is that this hurts the interest of both the screened population by overdiagnosis and overtreatment of thyroid nodules, and hurts the interest of thyroid patients because of the resource deprivation. The magnitude of the problem is perhaps illustrated by the fact that in 2015, 30% of patients who was first appeared on a thyroid order were examined for previous ultrasound screening. Going further in the algorithm, the next problem is the interpretation of the nodule. This has been already mentioned. The issue is that even a healthy thyroid inevitably has discrete lesions. The presence of tiny discrete lesions is not the exception, but the rule. Hashimoto is the real problem, as the most common ultrasound sign is a discrete structural abnormality of at least 5 mm, which is found in more than 90% of Hashimoto's patients. Considering the magnitude of the problem, it is very strange that the thyroid literature completely neglects this issue. I will give some clues here, but I will devote a separate chapter to this problem in a later advanced course. I emphasize here that the issue is first of all not a matter of terminology, but more importantly a matter of causing unnecessary anxiety to the patients. And now we are at the end of the algorithm, at the indication of FNA. All guidelines published after 2006 rely on suspicious signs in nodules between 1 and 2 cm. Let's see these suspicious signs. I mention here that during the entire course I rely on the guidelines of 5 professional societies. These are the common guidelines of the American Association of Clinical Endocrinologists and American College of Endocrinology, the American College of Radiology, the American Thyroid Association, the European Thyroid Association, and the Korean Society of Thyroid Radiology. The discussion of these ultrasound features is the backbone of the course. This time I will not merge in the details, I only point out that the first 4 that all companies value as suspicious sign. The echogenicity of the nodule is the most important one. 2 societies make distinction between deep and non-deep hypoechogenicity. Those who make and list deep hypoechogenicity among suspicious characteristics. Societies that do not discriminate hypoechogenic nodules take hypoechogenicity even more seriously. This is because it is a necessary condition that in the presence of any other suspicious signs, the nodule is classified in the most suspicious category. Let's see some examples. The left upper nodule is darker than the strep muscle, therefore this is a deeply hypoechoic lesion. The left lower nodule has several bright echogenic foci, microcalcifications. The depth of the right upper nodule exceeds the width, it means a taller than wide shape. This nodule also has irregular lobulated margins. The right lower nodule clearly extends into the strep muscle. The common in these 4 different cases that all prove to be papillary cancer. And this is no accident. We should never forget about the fact that suspicious sign means suspicious of papillary cancer. Because overwhelming majority of thyroid cancers are papillary tumors, therefore the features of papillary cancer determine what we think is a suspicious sign for all thyroid cancer. This proposal is a matter of concern in 2 cases. Both are cancers that do not or much less frequently show the suspicious signs on which neural systems are based. These are follicular cancer and the follicular variant of papillary cancer. This is a very important figure from the work of Ye and coworkers. We can see that papillary and follicular cancer behave completely opposite for each and every suspicious characteristics. Note that the difference is not only of statistical significance, comparing all values the difference is of very practical relevance. The situation is almost similar if we compare the conventional form of papillary cancer with the follicular variant. Except for the shape, these 2 variants behave again completely opposite. So what are the consequences? If we rely on suspicious characteristics of papillary cancer in indicating FNA, a significant proportion of follicular cancers and follicular variant of papillary cancers less than 2 cm in maximal diameter remains undiagnosed. This ratio is 50% in the event of follicular cancer. This concern affects all guidelines published after 2006 and all thyroid systems because they rely on suspicious findings of papillary cancer when indicating FNA in all thyroid nodules. Here I only quote 2 conclusions of a recent large meta-analysis. These are hard but well-established statements. 2 clear questions inevitably arise from these clear conclusions. I think these conclusions call into question all the guideline proposals and the practice based on them. I have to mention here that the ultrasound presentation of the 3rd frequent subtype of thyroid cancers, the medullary cancer, is very close to that of papillary cancer. The answer to the question fundamentally influences our everyday practice. For the sake of comparison, I present here the simplified version of the algorithm which was generally accepted and used earlier. On this proposal, we had to perform FNA in all nodules larger than 1 cm in maximal diameter. The analysis of various ultrasound characteristics influenced the decision on FNA only in sub-centimeter nodules. This table compares the two approaches. The only relevant difference affects nodules between 1 and 2 cm in maximal diameter. In this cohort of patients, we can see two important differences. There are significant proportion of cancers which will be missed if we apply recent suggestions. Up to 50% of follicular cancers will be missed. On the other hand, we can spare unnecessary FNA in benign nodules. If we give not the ratios but the absolute numbers, the perspective is different. This is a theoretical table of 1000 patients with nodules between 1 and 2 cm and with the assumption of 10% rate of cancer and the 90 to 10% ratio of papillary to follicular cancers. We save 360 tests at the cost of not detecting 18 cancers. I do not want to go into further detail because this is the subject of a separate chapter. One single conclusion. The significance of the failure of timely diagnosis in these two cancers is not yet clear. Until this problem is reassuringly clarified, it would be a serious mistake to make mandatory the recommendation of the guidelines. Each investigation team must decide which of the two algorithms to follow. This decision has an important effect on the role of ultrasound. Comparing the two algorithms, we can realize that the analysis of ultrasound characteristics is crucial in one, while almost irrelevant in the other case. In the newer guidelines, a thorough analysis of the ultrasound pattern is required because in great proportion of nodules, the justification of FNA depends on the lack or presence of suspicious findings. In the older guideline, mainly the three diameters measured by ultrasound matter. It seems that if one follows the previous suggestions, this whole course is actually superfluous. With a few hours of practice, everyone is able to recognize the thyroid gland and measure the size of the lobes and nodules. Fortunately or unfortunately, this is not the case, as we will see in the upcoming section. Regardless of which procedure we follow, here comes the next role of ultrasound. This is the guidance of aspiration cytology. The accepted method is to perform aspiration with US guidance. The only exceptions are nodules that are homogeneous. There is no part of them that is more suspicious than the others and which are well palpable. However, ultrasound examination is mandatory even in such lesions. In ideal circumstances, the role of ultrasound would be finished in indication of surgery. But the circumstances at best are only optimal and exceptionally ideal. The first issue is a professional one. We have known for a very long time that papillary cancer does not behave as a cancer in many cases. The data are clear. In most cases, a solitary microcarcinoma of less than 1 cm has no negative consequence even without surgery. Therefore, in the last 10 years, the justification for surgery is not clear for all cancers. This is one of the hottest topics these days in the thyroidology. There is no widely accepted position. But for sure, the size of the nodule is one of the most important considerations when it comes to surgery. Other ultrasound characteristics are also worth considering. A nodule showing ultrasound signs of extrathyroidal extension or a pattern suspicious of multifocality should be taken into account much seriously than a nodule without any signs suggesting an aggressive behavior. The other issue comes from everyday practice. Some well-known examples. Patients may refuse cytology, or cytology can be non-diagnostic. In these cases, the reviewing of ultrasound may be of the greatest help defining further steps. There are certain ultrasound patterns which are highly suspicious of malignancy. In such cases, surgery should be considered even when the FNA is benign. There are also much less studied options. I will mention only one here. In the case of cytologically diagnosed follicular tumors, up to 40 to 50% not only do not have cancer, but not even a benign tumor, a very significant part of the lesions turns out to be simple hyperplastic nodules. This ratio is even higher in those cases which are only suspicious for follicular neoplasia. In these cases, ultrasound could very often help avoid unnecessary surgery. Details I provided in a later chapter. Here I am only suggesting that in individual cases, ultrasound may play a role in the decision even after a clear cytological examination. A common sonocytological diagnosis can in many cases save the patient from unnecessary surgery or even lead to otherwise missed surgery. The final role of ultrasound is the follow-up of patients who avoided surgery. The goals of the follow-up are very similar to that of the first examination. We should decide whether a patient has or has not to be operated on. Regarding the hyperthyroidism, the TSH test is the pivotal. If a patient needs to be referred for surgery during a checkup, the most common cause is an increase in the nodular lobe. The pivotal is the measurement of the nodule and the nodular lobe. If the three diameters of the nodules and lobes were not given at the first examination, the patient and the examining physician were deprived of the most or only important information at follow-up. Considering the degree of inter-observer variation, it would be desirable to perform the first and subsequent examinations by the same physician. Except for cystic lesions, a benign nodule grows very slowly. Even in the case of a relatively fast-growing nodule, it takes several years for the rate of growth to exceed the intra-observer variation. So a check sooner than a year has very limited sense except for newly developed complaints. The third reason for performing follow-up is the recognition of cancers missed at the first examination. As a rule, we don't have to expect a benign nodule to get cancerous, however, the FNA can fail. Nowadays, routine repetition of cytological examination is not recommended. However, the justification for this should be determined for each aberration grab based on the experience of the sampler and the cytologist. In nodules showing suspicious signs, repeating the cytology once does seem rational, even for non-growing nodules. If a benign appearing nodule grows significantly, it is by more than 30% in volume, the repeat FNA can calm both the patient and the physician. Now we are at the end of the lecture. We demonstrated the role of thyroid ultrasound in all phases of evaluation of nodular goiter patients. Ultrasound is the only means of recognizing the nodule. Its role is crucial in deciding whether to operate on a patient. And ultrasound is an essential tool for the subsequent screening of non-surgical nodular patients. Some take-home messages. The data suggest that ultrasound screening has more harm than good to screen persons, and further examinations generated by the screening clearly impairs the real thyroid patient's access to care. The three diameters of not only the nodule but also the lobe must be measured. This measurement is the basis not only for our current decision, but for later examination we can use it to decide whether, for example, a recent neck complaint can be explained by an enlarged thyroid gland. And obviously, it also helps to determine if the nodule has grown. We need to be aware that when someone talks about suspicious signs of thyroid cancer, he or she is making it inaccurately. These signs are characteristic of papillary cancer, while follicular cancer presents not even one of these suspicious features. Finally, we are professionally responsible for the patient being examined, not for complying with the guideline. This is especially the case if the proposal of the guideline is questionable. and this is the case for indication cytology in nodules between 1 and 2 cm. Thank you very much for your attention.